Right. Thank you, Professor Poston, for meeting with me today. I'd like to ask you a couple of questions about your paper with Karen Glover in 2005 about too many males in China. In particular, first of all, what were the issues that brought this to your attention in the first place? How did you get started looking at sex ratios in China?
Looking at the sex ratio at birth, that's a good question. I've been looking at it now for 15 years, more than maybe 15 years, and I guess I must have been in talking with Chinese colleagues. I just retired after 49 years, and I've trained about 15 or 20 Chinese demographers who are now back in the country, in China. And one of them or two of them may have mentioned to me, Dudley, did you realize the SRB, the sex ratio at birth, is way out of balance?
Mm-hmm.
So somebody brought it to my attention, and I noticed that it was up probably in the 1990s. It may have gotten up to be 115, and then in 2000, 205, mm-hmm. 120. Now it's coming down now. Now, 2019, it's down now to about 111, 112, but still not back to the 105.
So it could have been some of your Chinese colleagues who brought this to your attention.
Yeah, that's right.
Once you got interested and started working on this, obviously you were working with some other people because Karen Glover is the co-author of this paper.
Yeah.
How was she involved in this and other people? Who were you talking to about this? Or were you doing this? You weren't doing this all on your own.
No, I was not. Karen was a graduate student then at Texas A&M. She's now a professor at Cal State San Marcos. So she was helping me run the data. The people I was working with, the closest, were Bao Changgu, Ji Yu, mm-hmm. who was my first Chinese student, came to Austin in 81, went back to China in 86, and worked for 15 or 20 years with the China Family Planning Association.
Mm-hmm.
So I was speaking very closely to him. And then about that time, his daughter was then at Texas A&M studying with me, and I was in more contact with Gu, but he was a top Chinese, one of my very best Chinese students. And he might have been the one who alerted me to the sex ratio at birth, because in our mm-hmm. classes, in our demography classes, we always note that it's about 105 to 106, probably biological,
normally.
Universal, yeah, because we men don't live as long as women do, so we die off more quickly, and you need that 105, 106 at birth.
That's the cushion.
For there to be a balance when marriage ages. So Gu Baochang knew that, and he probably then saw that it was way out of focus. We began then to look into what was going on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, now in this article, there's a preamble at the beginning about the population policies in China and Mao Zedong and the
right,
other people, and the extraordinarily low birth rates that were produced by Chinese population policy. And I wonder if you'd just say a word about why it was so important to start with that fertility decline to very low levels in order to talk about sex ratios.
It was, you need to have, well, talking with Gu Baochang and other demographers, not only Chinese, we sort of come to the conclusion that you need to have four things going on for there to be a seriously unbalanced sex ratio at birth.
Okay.
And one of the four things is a real rapid fertility reduction.
Mm-hmm.
So we showed in that 2005 paper that, and other papers, that China dropped from a total fertility rate of in the sixes, mid-sixes in 1960, down to, I think it was down to 2.5 in about 20
mm-hmm.
years, as did South Korea, as did Taiwan,
right.
and as did India a little bit later. So if you have a quick fertility reduction, 20 to 30 years, not whereas in our country it took us 150 years
right.
to go from 7 down to 2. And then secondly, then, part of the culture having son preference.
Second thing,
that's heavily Confucian, and the countries I just mentioned are all Confucian-oriented
mm-hmm.
countries. Now, India is not, but India also has
sun preference.
Yeah.
Definitely.
And then thirdly, cultural and physical opportunities for abortion.
Okay, it has to be possible.
And then fourthly, although I should have said the fourth one, third, the opportunity to identify the sex of the fetus.
Mm-hmm.
And nowadays in China, that's almost every place. You have these trucks, these little machines that are like almost like a portable, all those old portable computers that I can identify the sex. So when you have all four of those things, you're going to have an unbalanced sex ratio.
You can get sex selection because there's the means and the motive, both.
The means and the motive, and you need to have those boys. Mm-hmm. And you need to have those boys to be able to carry on the family name, the ancestor tablets, the daughters in the traditional times were sent out to marry at age 14 or 15. So it was those four things you need, and you see those in India, you see it in Taiwan, Korea, mm-hmm. and that got us sort of into this.
Now, you also spent some time in the article being a little careful as a good demographer and talking about whether we should really believe the sex ratio publications, and there were a couple different sources of data, and I wonder if you just say a word deciding which sex ratio at birth to believe in China.
Yeah, because we were just starting off using the census, the SRB as produced mm-hmm. in the census. But Dan Goodkind, mm-hmm. a demographer of the Census Bureau, has pointed out that we need to be a little cautious there, because there is an opportunity for maybe the girls to be hidden. Maybe mm-hmm. maybe they would not be reported.
Given away to a cousin.
Maybe just not reported. But in fact, Ansley Cole and Judith Bannister looked into that issue. Well, if they were hidden at birth, 10 years later, are they still? Has the SRB come back to where it should be at age 10?
In the population,
and Ansley, this is Judith Bannister, and he did some work on this back in the 90s, mm-hmm. and showed that the SRB was back to where it should, it was still out of balance, in other words, so that they concluded that there weren't that many girls hidden, not reported in the census. Mm-hmm. But we were entertaining these issues to see, because when we took the numbers, now in the paper with Karen, we had an estimated about 26 million bachelors.
Right.
In our more recent analysis in 2011, 2012, that's since the SRB was still up at 118, the number then was about 40 million. But even if you take Dan Goodkind's reluctance and hesitation, it still would be 35 million bachelors.
Yeah. That's where I want to go next, is to ask you about the consequences of this sex ratio imbalance. Yeah. That's what this article is mainly about, because it's called Too Many Males.
Too Many Males. And the Chinese, in Chinese, the term is Guang Gun, the romanization G-U-A-N-G, G-U-N, for bare branches.
Mm-hmm.
So bare branches, they have no branches on their trees, and they're called Guang Gun, mm-hmm. These bachelors. So what could happen? So we entertained some various possibilities. Again, talking with my students about this, my Chinese students, could there be an increase in homosexuality? All these bachelors, no women. Well, I mean, we know there's a little bit of social constructionism there, but
yes,
a lot of sexual orientation is genetically based. So I don't suspect you're going to see a ton of. Although you see in the Chinese press a lot of, there'll be more gay men.
So gayberhoods everywhere full of all these bachelors.
But you probably would have more. Gubo Chang was telling me it's likely you'll have more, and he sees this in China now, more gay men maybe coming out of the closet and identifying as gay, but not beginning to. So we said, no, that's not a real important mm-hmm. result. What about androgyny? What about turning to women having many husbands? But there's, among the 55 Chinese minorities, there are one or two mountainous groups, small minority groups.
With polyandry?
They're polyandry. Polyandry is what I mean.
Yes.
Polyandrous, not polygyny. And there are a couple there, but there's a very small number.
Are they also matrilineal?
Yes, they're matrilineal as well.
And the Han are definitely not.
No. And that's 92% of the population.
Yeah.
And that's not going to be. What happens is the men are away for a year
right.
and a half for mining jobs and other things, so the woman has two or three husbands, but that's probably not going to be the issue.
Mm-hmm.
Then what do you think about, bringing in brides from other countries? Yeah. Now, the Guang Gun in China are mainly rural poor, what do we in America would say, the bottom of the barrel.
Mm-hmm.
They're the ones people don't want, and they don't have the money to bring in brides from other places.
And those other places, the women are not going to go to China to get married.
And they're not going to go to China. Now, South Korea has, their SRB is getting close back to normal, and they've generated maybe about 1 million bachelors. And a lot of those bachelors are bringing in women from other countries. They have the money. South Korea is a much more prosperous country than China, at least back 10, 15 years. So they're bringing in women. But even if you did bring in women, what would then happen in the other countries that have normal SRBs?
You're spreading the problem around.
So that's, we didn't think that that would be the answer in China with even 35 million bachelors. So what we end up thinking is we're probably likely going to have bachelor ghettos, where a lot of these bachelors will move to maybe ghettos in the big cities, mm-hmm. much like they did in the United States after the Chinese finished helping building the railroad and the gold.
Chinatowns.
And the Chinatowns back in the 1890s, 19, even my hometown of San Francisco, they were mainly men.
Right.
And you probably would have that in maybe in Beijing, Nanjing, Shanghai, the big cities, mm-hmm. and they would then rely on commercial sex.
Mm-hmm.
And
now you mentioned
the sex market has now
sex increased. Behavior for these young guys are going to have a lot of testosterone, and they're going to be interested in sex, but they also will be interested in social connections and relationships and worthwhile roles. I wonder, have you ever thought about the other sex ratio imbalance in populations in connection with this? And that is, as people get older, the men all die off, and there's lots of older women by themselves, and here you've got all these younger men by themselves. Is there any possibility for an adjustment there?
I've never even thought about that. That would be, so you have women, the men are dying off in their 40s and 50s and 60s, and you have more and more women. The sex ratio, like in our country, United States, the sex ratio becomes even at about age 40.
Right.
And then it starts to
And later
drop
on,
down.
It's Jan and Dean, two girls for every boy.
I think Kingsley, your professor, Kingsley Davis, pointed out that if you only looked at men who were not married at age, they're about one in 10, one man for every ten women. But I think
they could have, if we could just convince
younger
men to pair up with women who are older than them instead of younger than them, and just shift the whole distribution so all men are connecting with women about 10 years older than themselves.
I tell my undergraduate students, you probably say the same thing to yours, that these young girls, 20, 21 years of age in our classes, who are, some of them might be looking for husbands, but they're looking for husbands who are 24. I say, you're looking for husbands who are 17.
Yeah.
And then you'll then die at the same time as your husbands.
And you give those young guys a break.
you go into the old age homes, what do you see? You don't see a bunch of old men, you and me, sitting around playing poker. There are a bunch
We're
of
all
old
gone.
Ladies, old ladies playing bridge.
Yeah,
there just aren't many men there.
Yeah, my mom was in a place like that. It was a girl's dorm.
Yeah.
Basically.
Well, our good friend Charlie Nam tells us that in the place where he's living now, it's loads and loads of old ladies and not many men.
And so there's been a sex ratio imbalance in the other direction, and it's getting more and more serious. Mm-hmm. But in China, you're having this young age imbalance in the other direction. Now, the most serious possibility that you floated was the military possibility.
Let me just mention one other thing with regard, before we get into the military issue and crime, another one,
mm-hmm.
is the possibilities for HIV and sexually transmitted mm-hmm. infections. There we have seen, Gubo Chang and others have pointed out to me, increases in the big cities as more and more sex workers have come to satisfy many of these bachelors. There's been an increase in sexually transmitted infections and HIV.
They might end up eliminating themselves.
And Joseph Joe Tucker, a medical demographer, used to be at North Carolina, did some simulations and showed that there could be, if the present increases in HIV is still pretty low in China, but if the rate at which it's been increasing continues, China could be rivaling sub-Saharan Africa in maybe 20 or 30 years.
All you have to do is just deny it's happening, and you're in trouble.
Right. But on this issue of the military, what has happened in other countries when they've had more men? Portugal sent off men to Northern Africa to fight in wars. China could easily, when I talk about this in China, they sort of laugh at it a little bit, but China could very easily send off 1 or 2 million people to fight Taiwan. Yeah, and not even lose them. It wouldn't be a big deal because they've got 35 million of these bachelors. We don't see any evidence of that happening.
No, but there would go Central Asia, there, gone.
Now, the other issue that American sociologist Bob Sampson John Loeb have pointed out is that when you have a lot of young men unattached, the crime rate goes up tremendously. Mm-hmm. We haven't seen any evidence of that yet in China, but all we know is that...
Maybe the facial recognition software helps
maybe
to prevent that.
Maybe that might not reported it. But all we know is that these boys are there. It's probably not 40 million, even if you take Dan Goodkind's hesitation or reluctance to use the SRB data at birth that are reported. There's a lot of bachelors are there. And Kuba Chang tells me there are lots of boys around China, many more than before. Girls can now choose. You go into Beijing or to Shanghai, they have big parks. And along the walls of each park is a one page about this size. Each boy will have his picture and his telephone number and how many does he have a job and a flat, and they'll be listed. And the girls, the girls and their parents will be looking at this, and they're then able to choose boys who they might want to make a connection with. Mm-hmm.
They're in the driver's seat.
So that's really the story.
So that was, you're kind of already into my next question, is what have you heard about this article and about the ideas in it since you published the article? Is it coming true, and if so, which parts?
Well, the part that the 05 publication, we followed that with a couple of book chapters, and then the 2011 piece, which I mentioned, a little bit shorter analysis, but there is an imbalance. It may not be 40 million, but there is an imbalance. There are a lot of bachelors in the future. Mm-hmm. China is not going to be, by the year 2020, is not going to be back at 106. It may be at 110 or so. But so the numbers, the problem has not yet gone away.
But in the long view, this is a kind of temporary problem in that you think it'll go away eventually.
Yes, although...
because the fertility restrictions are less now.
And the fertility restrictions are less, but the young girls are not having more boys. China's did away with the one-child policy about 2 or 3 years ago.
Yeah.
And so you can now have two children. Guo Bochang was telling me that of the 14 million women who would be able to have the second child in the year 2017, I think he said, only 1 million took advantage of it.
Huh?
So, because most of these girls, they're going to college. They're able to have some of their own money. They're not having to go off and live with their mother-in-law.
It's all over the world.
So the birth rate is not going to go back up to 2 and 3. It'll stay at 1.6.
So this will remain a problem to some extent.
And there has been an increase in crime. There has been an increases in the HIV. It's on the increase. Sex workers are in the big cities taking care of a lot of these bachelors, so we have seen that.
But no military adventures yet.
No, not that I know of.
Not yet. Okay. So you think that in the long run, this large excess of men, as they get older, will they cease to be a problem? Well, when they leave behind the high testosterone ages, and as they begin to disappear relative to the number of women, could this in the long run actually be an advantage for old age in China, because there'll be more men around by the time they get really old?
I thought
50 years from now.
Yeah, that would be very interesting to... Because the SRB, it's going to eventually come back to 107, 108, another 10 years. So this problem will go away. But you've got all those bachelors.
And those bachelors are a potential balance against the old age sex ratio problem in the other direction.
And so that a lot of these husbands die off, these older women wouldn't have to be
alone.
Widows. They would have other men to draw on.
Plenty.
We've not pursued that yet.
Well, that's your next paper. So I'll look forward to being able to assign that one too. And I'd like to thank you very much for this opportunity.
Thank you. Very neat. Yeah.